Everybody, Bunkhouse Bob and Lovely Lori here. Folks, does the man make the title or does the title make the man? Age-old question with a simple answer. That is if you're wearing a title made by Top Rope Belts.
Established in 2006 and with a satisfied client list, including Lucha Underground, the LA Dodgers, New Japan Pro Wrestling, Ohio Valley Wrestling, the National Wrestling Alliance, and many, many more. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawings and does all of their own etching. That means quality from start to finish, folks.
Folks, whether you're a private collector, a wrestling promotion, or a business who wants a quality championship title belt, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out on Facebook or visit them at www.topropebelts.com. Everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Laura.
Folks, live from the Armory Wrestling Show is the flagship program of FNX.network. Make no mistake about it, we are the flagship program of FNX. But please go and check out great shows like Wrestle Radio Australia, Shoot the Defense, World's Almost Finest Podcast, but of course, listen to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, heard only on
FNX.
See ya.
Hey guys, it's Kiera Hogan, the girl on fire, and you are listening live from the Armory Wrestling Show.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
We'll have to put out like a disclaimer. Stu Young says do not Google Taco Slapper.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
That sounds like you don't have a lot of confidence in the Bravado Brothers against one Adam Page and Corey Hollis.
And the lovely Laura.
I don't trust that hobbit and that hillbilly.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is Bunkhouse Bob, and I'm the co-host of this program. Joining me in just a moment, as she does each and every week, will be the other co-host, the lovely Laura. Folks, whether you're a first-time listener or you've been dragging along behind of us, this is episode 159, Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. We thank you very much for tuning in tonight, folks. We've got a great guest for you. Coming up at 7:30, folks, he is part of the Carnies, part of the counterculture, one of those sinners that never sleeps. One Mr. Tripp Cassidy will be with us tonight at 7:30. Folks, again, we thank you for tuning in tonight. We would encourage you to check out all the great content over on FNX Network. You can go to www.fnx.network. A lot of cool shows over there. Wrestle Radio Australia, Shoot the Defense, World's Almost Finest, whole bunch of stuff. Just need to go over, check it out at fnx.network. This show 100% supports hashtag Project Kindness. If you'd like information on hashtag Project Kindness, go to Facebook and check out Lala Wilkins or Steve Wilkins. They can hook you up with some info on that. We also support Ignite Advocacy. If you go to www.ignitewrestling.com, or if you get on Facebook again, like you do every day at work, twiddling away the hours, waiting for cat videos to come along, you can go to Ignite Wrestling on Facebook or Ignite Advocacy on Facebook. Check out Kim and all the work that they're doing in the Florida community. A lot of people consider Florida not a separate state, but an entirely different planet. And speaking of Janet from another planet, I'd like to bring on the other co-host of the program, the lovely Laura.
Meow.
How are you, girl?
Oh, Bob, I am just beside myself.
Why are you
I'm
beside
so pretty.
Yourself?
I'm so pretty.
Oh.
You know, I kiss myself. I'm so pretty.
A la Dusty Rose. I hear you.
That's right.
How are you? How you been doing? You all right?
You know, all right. John and I went to the Gary Michael Capetta show in Greensboro this past Sunday.
Yes.
We were not sure if we were going to get to go, and that's why we didn't talk about it a whole lot to people, because of weather. But
mm-hmm.
that was just the best thing ever, you know, to hear him talk about, especially Gorilla Monsoon. Gorilla Monsoon helped him get into the business. It was just so great, and getting to hang out with the AML guys, the One Man Riot, Zane Dawson, the AML Champ, and the Geordie Bulldogs, who are always entertaining, and getting to see our good friend Tracy Myers and Brian Hawks, and it was just a lot of fun, and brought back a lot of memories, especially the old NWA days. Gary Michael was there the night that they brought Magnum TA down for the first time in Baltimore at the Crockett Cup.
And his tour that he's doing is called Beyond Body Slams.
That is true. And he's got a book.
Mm-hmm.
And he is so entertaining. If you're a wrestling fan, an old school wrestling fan, I highly suggest you go to this show. It is absolutely wonderful. I had no idea, he even did work for Ring of Honor when they first got started. Didn't have a clue.
Mm-hmm. That vaguely rings a bell.
He did some backstage stuff. He didn't do like ring announcing. And one of the funniest things is he talks about when Elegante was first when he first debuted on the pay per view. He wasn't wrestling. He just came out. And
right.
Not been a pay per view. But anyway, just really good stuff. And he's so entertaining. Such a nice guy. He's on his book tour. If he's coming to your area, go see him. I mean, especially if you're a wrestling fan, old school wrestling fan, even if you're, just getting into wrestling, there's some great stories there with some of the legends of the business and just fantastic storyteller. Seriously, go see him.
Yeah, he's very active on Facebook. And posting
right.
Tour dates and information links and all that. So if you go to Facebook and go simply search Gary Michael Capetta on Facebook, there's only one. It'll pop up immediately. And go like the page, check it out. I'm glad you had a good time. What anything in particular? Anything really jump out at you?
He was talking about Mick Foley losing his ear in Germany.
Yeah.
And, the story was that Vader ripped it off. And Vader,
right.
for years, I didn't rip it off. He did
right.
rip it off, and it wasn't like he just, that ear was just hanging on by a wing and a prayer.
Yeah, he fully did that move that he does. It was kind of like a hangman's move where
right.
he would get tossed over the rope and bring the rope around, and it would seem like he was hanging. And when he pulled his head out of the ropes, it tore his ear. And
right.
The thing I remember,
it just got worse.
Yeah. The thing I remember was reading in Mick Foley's book about the lack of concern by the backstage staff in Germany. And he's like, my ear's gone. Where's my ear at? And I think somebody actually picked up the part of the ear and put it in a bag of ice.
Well, what happened
right.
was the referee, who was French, didn't speak any English, gave the ear to Gary Michael Capetta.
There you go. There's the tie-in.
He had to run to the back. And
yeah.
people, Ric Flair is like, oh, my God, that's an ear. And Gary Michael Capetta is like, yeah, that's what I've been trying to tell you. This is Cactus's ear. And here comes Sting, and he's like, oh, my God, that's so cool. And Gary Michael Capetta is like, people, I've got to get this into ice. This is Mick's ear. So they wouldn't let him take it home.
Around looking at it.
Yes, oh, my God, it's an ear. Yeah, it's an ear. But yeah, the hospital in Germany wouldn't let him take it home.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, they tried to reattach it, and obviously, unfortunately, I guess too much time had elapsed.
Yeah.
That was a great story that he told about that. It was just Sid Vicious Arn Anderson brawl. He talked about that because he was right next door to all that. And just some stuff about WCW, about how things kind of went, you know, down at the end of his tenure.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, the ROH stuff was really interesting. I had no clue that he was even doing anything with ROH. But, yeah, I highly recommend it. You know, go out and see it. If you're a wrestling fan, you appreciate old school wrestling. Or even if you're a new wrestling fan, there were a couple of people who were just new to wrestling who, you know, totally enjoyed it too. So, yeah, I mean, he's great. So, you know, you got some time to kill on a Saturday or Sunday, go see him.
Make sure you check out Gary Michael Capetta on Facebook, on social media. And speaking of social media, you want to go on and give out our info?
Yes, I'm sorry I jumped the ship there a little bit. I'm tweeting along tonight at From the Armory. You can tweet along with me. It's always a blast to see everybody tweeting back with me. So, come on. You know you want it. All the cool kids are doing it. And we are on Facebook. We have two Facebook pages. We have the official Live from the Armory Facebook page, which is at facebook.com/live.armory.9. You can join our closed group, which is fans of Live from the Armory. You do have to ask to be admitted. We also have a YouTube page, which just go into YouTube and search Live from the Armory. We've got a couple of matches up there. Every time I go to a wrestling match, I totally forget to do that. But that just shows that, hey, I'm a fan. So, sorry.
There you go.
And, you know, we've been kicking around the Instagram
IGN.
Just
go on and do it.
Well, I might. We'll just see. Right. But anyway, let me tell you that Bob and I and our co-executive producer, George Coles, have shoot Twitters. That is Ethan Case approved right there. At Turtle Sky for me, at Bob_Delp for Bunkhouse Bob, and at Heel Heat. Is it at Heel Heat Show?
I believe that's correct. Is Coles even working tonight? He can't even plug his
I don't know if Coles is working tonight or not. I haven't heard him. I know that his birthday is next week.
Yes, his birthday is next week, and we'll certainly pop off fireworks and bake a cake and have some freeze-dried cupcakes sent in and all that other good stuff from Mr. Cole's
birthday.
Well,
you know how to treat somebody, don't you, Bob? Your wife must be just, you know, the most
like what you
happiest
said
woman
at the
on the face of this earth.
Well, it's like what you said at the beginning of the show. She is beside herself.
Yeah, I bet she is.
She is.
George is at Heel Heat. You can find him on Twitter there. And that's all the social media stuff I got, Bob.
What else did you see other than the musings of one Gary Michael Capetta this week? What else did you see?
Well, I was so proud to see James Drake on the Flow Slam Facebook. They had put up George is present and accounted for. He's here. He's working.
Thank God.
Did you see where they featured the match he had down in Florida? And
I saw
the name of his opponent. It escapes me, and I do apologize. But I was just so proud to see him, you know, chopping the crap out of that guy. you know, just so proud of Drake.
I saw the 30-second snippet. If that's the snippet that you're talking about, basically it's just the promotion of the show, which it was another style battle, if I'm not mistaken.
Gotcha.
I'm almost positive, right. But I cannot remember the other gentleman's name. I mean, obviously, I'm sure if you tweet it out to James, he'll hopefully provide that information for us. Because, yeah, they were laying the lumber to one another, that's for sure.
And you just don't do that with James. You just don't, you know.
Toughest chop in the business.
He really is. I would put his chop up against Big Country.
That's saying a lot. Because his chop is legit one of the toughest chops in the business. You don't have to believe me. You don't have to take my word for it. If you're a trained professional wrestler and you want to find out, you can, I'm sure, simply ask James for an invitation to dance, and he'd be more than happy to show you. So that's all.
Oh, yes, and I do want to say real quick that another highlight of the week, and let me make sure that you're not going to talk about this down in your little notes here. Ring of Honor. I know what you're going to talk about. I just want to say that it was so good to see Matt and Jeff Hardy on Ring of Honor. And that pay-per-view was probably the best Ring of Honor pay-per-view I've seen in a very long time.
That's good. The general consensus.
It was good from start to finish. And I just want to say something real quick, because I know that you're going to talk about Impact writing Maria and the Hardys off the show. What I want to say is this. If I were Impact Wrestling, I'd be concentrating on my product a little more than trying to get people to drop Ring of Honor's pay-per-view because they claim that the broken gimmick belongs to them. Here's a great idea. How about not worrying about a gimmick that you didn't like to begin with? Why do you want to own something you didn't like?
Money.
Work on your product, which, you know, I can say this right now is not up to par. The only reason I'll be watching it is for Caleb Conley. Until you impress me with something, I'm a little miffed. You know, and who, ladies and gentlemen, who would ever think that I would be miffed over the way Matt and Jeff Hardy are being treated? I mean, come on. I am miffed at this because let it go. You didn't seem to have a problem with them using that all over every indie show known to man. But now you've got a problem with the fact that they're taking what they created to Ring of Honor.
You're right, and we'll work a little backwards then. You were talking about Ring of Honor. Obviously, Christopher Daniels wins the Ring of Honor World Championship from Adam Cole. Long time coming. Christopher Daniels... always the bridesmaid and never the bride. Well, you know, now he's the bride and the groom. Congrats to Christopher Daniels on capturing the title. It would appear that with Adam Cole losing the title, that we're going to see an Adam Cole-Kenny Omega match. The table has been set between Adam Cole and the Young Bucks and Omega. If I had a dollar to bet George Coles, I could think of no better platform, no better venue, no bigger event to host that match than WrestleCon. I haven't heard anything. I'm not trying to imply anything. But if you're going to have a match of that magnitude, WrestleCon is the place that I would have it. I would watch and see what happens with this. Got very short time to make some announcements on it, but that's what I'm thinking. You mentioned, obviously, Impact Wrestling. A lot of people tuned in. I tuned in to see the relaunch, the rebranding of Impact Wrestling. Hopes were high. A lot of people were very optimistic, myself included. I can tell you that the opening video package, everything subsequently leading up to it, you know, the social media push, the announcement of the roster, the video packages, the pictures of everybody from the crew to catering, all had the earmark of
we're going full steam, 100% forward. We're going, the past is the past, and we're introducing a brand new product for you. And immediately we're left with, after the opening montage, we get nothing but a 2-hour show of listening to Josh Matthews and Jeremy Borash go back and forth. And not only did they distract from the show, they made the show take a complete nosedive, in my opinion, other than what was going on in the ring, not taking away from the in-ring work. These two guys are there to enhance the product, not be the product. Neither one of these gentlemen are Jim Ross. Yeah, neither one of these guys are Jim Ross. So let's just put that right out there up front. Just call the match. Or as like JR would say, just call the damn match, you know? Just call the match.
Exactly.
Don't need all that nonsense. And that's all it was nonsense. Obviously, they write the Hardys off. They write Maria off, Miracle Mike, all that other good stuff, come up with some lame stuff. Not long after that, then social media starts picking up on several things, including Ribby Hardy's Twitter attack, for lack of a better term, on Impact Wrestling and the Owl. I'm not going to repeat
I
what
love
she
that
said.
Woman.
There's a T-shirt that Ribby Hardy has put out, telling
that they
her
sold out of.
Yeah, telling her personal feelings of that Owl that sold 500 shirts in 24 hours.
Yep.
At figure $20 a pop, you can do the math. And it's exactly what you said. Impact Wrestling is concerned about what the Hardys are doing. They're claiming that in their contract, which is now expired, was a clause saying that anything that they created during their tenure there, Impact Wrestling had rights to. And what they're looking for is they're looking for a percentage of royalties or a percentage of income that the Hardys generate by using the Broken gimmick or the Brother Nero gimmick. And it's a money grab. And I don't think that it's going to work out too well in favor for Impact Wrestling. I don't feel it. What do you think?
Well, I think that there, you know, I don't know if a lot of people know this or not, but John was telling me that the parent company Anthem laid off a bunch of people here recently.
Yeah.
So, and a lot of people are pointing toward the purchase of TNA as the culprit of that. Could very well be, I don't know. But it seems to me they're wanting to make money off of two people who worked really hard, who saved the company, who carried the company. How about getting your show out of the Impact?
Yeah.
How about doing some small venues? Here's a a novel idea. How about getting some sponsors?
Yeah.
To generate some revenue.
I agree with you. This was one of the things that we talked about with Impact Wrestling when it was known as TNA. A year and a half ago, they tried to venture out to small arenas, small markets. Some they had success in, others not so much. But doing those loops certainly would have gave them a feel for what markets that they were viable in. But you're right, they're not making any revenue, not generating any revenue sitting at the Impact Zone. They're just not.
Nope.
And that's been a big sticking point and will be until they leave the Impact Zone and take the show on the road, so to speak.
I think they ought to do what NXT does, is run smaller venues in the state of Florida. Or hell, if you had to take it back to Tennessee, you know?
Well,
it's headquartered in Tennessee. Run the fairground.
I don't think the state of Tennessee wants them there, to be honest with you.
Well, because they owed them taxes, right?
Yeah, because of the back stuff. Now, I do know that Impact announced that they're going to do tapings in India on May 30th and 31st. But this is all part of that back deal with Sony 6. And there's a bunch of stuff that's involved with that that's got more legal jargon in it than what I care to spit out. I think that's part of that deal that they made all that hoopla about like 2 years ago. That fell flat. So I don't know. you're just going to have to wait and see. They're going to have to get out of the impact zone, and they're going to have to get off the Matt and Jeff Hardy bandwagon, because they're turning fans off with all this banner, all this talk of lawsuits and all that other junk. So,
well,
that,
you
that,
know,
that's my
it just opinion. Makes them look bitter. And two things real quick. James Drake says that it's John Davis, who his opponent was. And now that he said that, I'm like, yes, that's John Davis.
Okay.
And George says the highlights for him for the Impact from last Thursday were Dirty Dutch, which I thought that he concentrated too much on the WWE. I thought there for a second I was watching WWE.
Yeah.
So I was like, what is he doing? What is he talking? I mean, and I think he'd be great for the company. He's been a great booker. But I was kind of like, why are we promoting WWE here? You know?
Pritchard,
he's done a lot about WWE.
Pritchard did the same thing, talking about being at, you know, different places at points in time, you know, tying in success. You know, it's really quite easy, folks. He's dropping successful eras and trying to entice the fans into believing that this will be a successful era for Impact.
That they can
and I
duplicate
get that.
That.
Yeah, and I get that, and I understand it, but the better thing to do instead of standing in the ring and talking about it for an hour is put the talent in the ring and let them show it, because the talent that did that before, guess where they went? They're in the WWE now.
Right. Gloria.
So, yeah, exactly. Speaking of WWE, I did want to mention that Kerry Hojo of Stardom has signed a deal with the WWE. Again, we get this international flavor, getting spread our wings out. We talked about Demi Bennett a few weeks ago from Australia. International influence now playing a role in the product that you're going to see on the WWE on Monday Night Raw, SmackDown, and all those subsequent shows. And the last thing that I wanted to mention, and I'm sure that you picked up on this, Dennis Stamp passed away this week after his battle with cancer. Probably, fortunately, most well known for his role in the wrestling documentary Beyond the Mat. I'm not going, I'm not booked, you know, and doing the stuff on the trampoline,
right.
I don't do any tricks, you know, that kind of stuff. What a lot of people don't know, or let alone less fact, is that he is credited with wrestling Bret Hart in Hart's first professional wrestling match. Not a lot of people know that. Dennis Stamp was a prominent wrestler in the 70s and the 80s for various promotions. I don't
I've seen him on AWA a couple of times.
Yeah, I mean, the gentleman didn't achieve superstardom like some did, but obviously had a lot of friends in the business, a lot of extended family, and certainly want to send our condolences to his family and to his friends. Dennis Stamp has unfortunately left. So wanted to bring that up. The other thing I wanted to bring up, because I know that you and I had talked about this, and this will tie in with our big announcement later on in this broadcast as I turn the page. You have Netflix, don't you, Laura?
I do.
Well, you should be dancing in the streets of West Virginia tonight, because Lucha Underground,
I live in West Virginia.
I know, season one and season two launched today on Netflix. For those that do not have access to the El Rey Network, now you can see what all the hype is without having to stare at, you know, your tablet or your phone trying to watch YouTube clips or catch what's going on. And you can see the likes of Pentagon Jr. and Prince Puma and all the great talent.
Willie Mack.
Willie Mack. I mean, it's just, if you want to know, if you haven't had the opportunity to see what all the hype has been about with Lucha Underground, now you can do what the cool kids do. You can binge watch it. You can start at 6 in the morning and stay up till 6 the following morning and finish it all up, and then you'll know what everybody's been talking about, right?
That is correct, sir.
Are you going to watch?
Well, Yeah, Bob, because I have so much free time that I'm sitting here twiddling my thumbs all day, and I just have so much time.
You can make time for Prince Puma.
Especially when I don't have to whisper that.
Yeah, exactly. I really like what you do on Lucha Underground. I know you're Prince Puma.
I didn't say that. I said, I really like what you do on Wednesday nights. And he's like, you don't have to whisper that.
Of course, obviously, Laura talking about whispering to Ricochet. Saying,
right, at PWS.
I really like what you do. I really like it. Cool stuff. Cool stuff. Well, folks, we've come to that magical time of the evening where we have our guest. And have to have full disclosure here, folks. Tripp is not live with us tonight. We actually caught up with Tripp a few days ago, and our schedules allowed it. And Tripp is a very, very busy guy. He was very gracious with his time. And I know that you guys are going to enjoy this. So without any more from me or Laura, we're going to go on and run our interview with one Mr. Tripp Cassidy. Joining us this evening, folks, we're really excited to have this guy on. He's somebody that's been on the radar for quite some time, and if you're a fan of Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment or caught him in promotions up and down the East Coast, you know exactly what we're talking about. Joining us at this time is Mr. Tripp Cassidy. Tripp, how are you, sir?
Hey, what's up? How's it going?
Pretty good, man, pretty good. Obviously, with me on the other end of the line is the other co-host, Laura. Laura, you want to say hello to Tripp?
Hey, Tripp.
Well, hi.
Tripp, we certainly appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to be with us, man. We certainly appreciate the time.
Well, of course, same time, man.
In this up-and-coming generation of wrestling, what is it that you told yourself that you wanted to accomplish as a wrestler?
When I first got into the business, I didn't have a whole lot of big aspirations or goals or anything. All I initially wanted to do was be a pro wrestler. And then my second goal from being a professional wrestler was to be in the Inline Cup tournament for CHIKARA Pro Wrestling. And, I accomplished both those things really, really quickly. And everything after that's just been, goal by goal, step by step.
Are you a big fan? Are you a big proponent of goal setting? I know that that seems to be in the reoccurring theme this year after we had Brutal Bob Evans on the show was goal setting. How does that work for you?
Currently, as anybody that keeps up with anything I do or anything going on in Atlanta knows, I'm one-fourth of a group called the Carnies with Priscilla Kelly, Carrie Offal, and Nick Iggy. And that group goes so much deeper than just the business aspect of it, just the visual of what you see. Everything that we do has a very driven purpose. I've never been around a group of people that have pushed me the way that all of us do together. We don't just, leave it in the ring in between the ropes. Everything we do is very family-oriented. We have long business call conferences. We send each other everything, matches, content, YouTube videos, T-shirt designs. Everything that we do, we go through each other. So it's like we're a machine that drives this force behind all of us. So all of our goals are very held together. They're very very close knit. So one person's goal is not just one person's goal, but the four of us.
We're going to talk about your fellow mates in the Carnies here in just a few minutes, and you brought up some interesting points that I'll get back to. In talking with wrestlers over the past few years, Tripp, was there ever a concern on your end that you would find a gimmick that not only you could live with, but the fans as well would buy into?
Oh, absolutely. I talked about my Young Lions Cup time. I did quite a bit with CHIKARA Pro and with Mike Quackenbush and the Wrestling Is promotions early on in my career. And I went through a variety of different changes to my appearance, my character, to what I am and what I was. And it took me a while to, like, really flush out all the garbage and find what made me me. But once I went to Atlanta for the first time, like, Atlanta's just been one step of my career, but it's been the biggest step in finding who I am. And it's a culmination of, like, of years of being, you know, different variations of myself, and then just really finding, like, a mix of what made me me.
I know that a lot of fans are familiar with you in your work in Atlanta. I know I am, Lori is. But I also know a little bit about the wrestling scene in Indiana. And we've spoken to a couple of people from that area, and it's not being traditionally known as what some would call a hotbed of wrestling. Are fans overlooking the talent in that area, in your opinion?
Personally, one of my primary objectives as a wrestler, based off where I was taught and how I learned underneath Billy Rock as a trainee, was that it's our job to make the scene what it is. And since I've started wrestling, like, my entire goal has been to help the young kids and to help make the scene better. And in the last, you know, 7 years, I feel like over time, a very, very broken down scene or niche of wrestling in Indiana has really fixed itself. There are a lot of young guys here now that I'm helping do everything I can for that are really making a name for themselves. In the next couple of years, I feel like the Indiana wrestling scene is only going to get much, much better. And it's definitely improved, and I'm proud of where it's gone and what's to come with guys like Cole Radrick and Jonathan Wolf and Calvin Tankman and Sean Kemp. Like, these kids, like, they're all, you know, 15, 17, 19 years old, and they only have, you know, years and years to become better and better, and they're in much better places than any of us were between, like, me and Ace Perry and Dale Patrick, like, Josh Crane, any of these guys that are trying to make a name for themselves from Indianapolis now.
You know, you mentioned something funny, and it's kind of sparked in my mind. Do you think there was, I don't know, what's the lack of a better term, a generation gap for a moment between the old school and the younger wrestler coming up that maybe perhaps weren't giving guys like yourself and gals that under the wing opportunity like you are with maybe some of the younger talent that you just mentioned?
Absolutely. I feel like there was a weird span of time where in Indianapolis or in Indiana in general, the entire state, it's a very segregated state. The fact that there's like a northern Indiana wrestling scene, a southern Indiana wrestling scene, and then there's kind of nothing in the middle. And that in the middle is where everything is. So we had guys like Drake Younger and Billy Rock and Spider Nate Webb, and these guys that they kind of went on to make the name for themselves. But like IWA Mid South has kind of been the only thing Smart Mark wrestling related, and to lose guys like that so early, like Drake was there for my career, and Billy Rock did everything for me and trained me. But like a lot of those guys, they weren't hands on in being the. They were already further along in their career than I was when I had the opportunity to help people out. So they didn't really have the opportunity to take us on the road or to teach things hands-on like I have the opportunity to now.
Well, we're talking with Tripp Cassidy. Tripp, we talked about it just a moment ago. Obviously, we would be remiss if we didn't mention people that you talked about who have been guests on this show, Nick Eagy, Carrie Offal, Priscilla Kelly. And you talked about being a common goal-oriented group. And the more that I thought about it when you were saying it, you can definitely see there is a sense and a purpose behind all of your posts, behind all of the videos. What has it meant for you not only to work with them professionally, but personally?
As far as Nick Iggy and Carrie Offal, we both came up at pretty much the same time. I'm a lot younger than Nick and Carrie, but I've been in the business for a while now. And when we came in together, we were kind of thrown into the Wolves with IWA Mid-South for Ian Rotten. It was just kind of a Wild West vibe, and to have guys like them that you could cling to and get along with immediately, like I did, it was nice to have that camaraderie. Like, myself, Kerry Alpha, and Nick Iggy all clicked very, very well together. And we've been friends from day one. To have the opportunity to work with them in a professional setting, as well as the opportunity to be much closer with them in a personal setting, has been absolutely perfect. Like, it's given me the family that I've always needed in wrestling. And when Priscilla Kelly came along, like, I didn't quite know how to take her at first, because she is a very, very interesting, unique individual. But watching her fight Mickey Knuckles, watching her fight Heidi Lovelace, watching her career grow over the short time that it has, she's become closer than anyone in the world to me. And between the four of us, I feel like it's an unbreakable bond. We've had our challenges, but absolutely, like, there's nothing in between us that can stop us from driving towards the goal that we have.
You mentioned Ian Rotten, whom fans will know from obviously IWA and will also remember as an ECW original. Depending on who you talk to at any particular given time or day, the consensus seems to be one of two things. One, he's either a great guy who's helped a lot of people out, or number two, he's a worthless individual whom nobody wants to associate with. What was your experience like with Mr. Rotten?
I'm going to definitely be one of the ones in the first category. Like, strangely enough, there's a lot of people who want to throw Ian under the bus or whatever, or say he's the type of person that he is, or he's carny, or he stabs people in the back, but Ian Rotten's done nothing but good for me. Like, of course, there's problems at IWA, and, like, things pop up, but with them running so frequently and then having them all in the locker room, the personalities that they do, things like that happen. But any wrestler knows when you're dealing with any kind of promoter, there are just quirks of each person, and you got to be prepared for what you're prepared for, and everybody knows what they're dealing with Ian. Ian's a great, great guy on the inside, and he's a fantastic person who's given a lot of young guys a very, very big platform and a very big opportunity from the get-go. Every week, I was at IWA Mid-South for like 2 years, 2.5 years, and like every time I've had the opportunity to wrestle for Ian, he's taken care of me. He's been a very, very good proponent of helping my career in a lot of ways, and I thank him for everything he's ever done for me.
I probably should have let Laura do this question, because she falls into this category. Tell me, Tripp, why sinners never sleep, and how does counterculture fit into the wrestling way of life? And Laura's running on zero sleep right now because she's a sinner, but tell me, Tripp, why sinners never sleep.
Sinners Never Sleep was originally just a tattoo that I had. It's one of my many life mottos that I follow for the sole purpose of I get very little sleep between hours and hours and hours on the road and my ridiculous work schedule and trying to keep my life together. It's a very it's very open ended. It's not necessarily
right.
Related to wrestling or to whatever. You know,
right.
Anybody knows that if you're outside of the spectrum of normal human being, to be a sinner is to stray away from the general, to stray away from the given morality. And anybody that knows that lifestyle knows that it requires a lot of effort to be the person
yes.
that you become.
Counterculture
is very wrestling specific, but it doesn't have to be. I mean, everyone knows what it's like to be different. Everyone knows what it's like to be their own unique individual that stays in their head and feels like they're not exactly what everybody else wants them to be. But
mm-hmm.
in my world, counterculture is us, like everyone that I know. Counterculture is the idea that we live in an era of contract guys. We live in an era of guys that you know, you live for a 5-minute style. You live for being the next guy to get some kind of offer to sell TV merchandise. And while everyone wants that, like, I was born and raised on independent wrestling. Like, independent wrestling is everything to me, and it's been my entire life since I was 13 years old. And I want nothing more than to give back everything I have to independent wrestling and live that life, you know, and sell myself as this is what I am, you know. I'm independent. I do it for me. And no one else is going to change that.
That's outstanding. I mean, Laura knows for sure what it is to have a thin moral fiber. And I could care less if we sold another Live from the Armory Wrestling Show t-shirt, which you can find only at ProWrestlingTees.com. But that's beside the point. Tripp, the fans at Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment are right up front, in your face, and make no bones about vocalizing their opinion of the product. Tell us about your first experience there. And are there too many promotions that are concerned with being, quote unquote, family friendly? And on the opposite side of that, is AWE missing the mark on being too adult oriented?
Well, there are a lot of people trying to play the PG card right now because, like I said, everyone lives in that weird contract era where everybody wants to be what they see on TV. And I feel like AWE is a great delineation from that because it's in such a unique place that, like, the fans of AWE are very, very specific and particular in what they like. And the first time I went to AWE was for a tryout show, and I hadn't wrestled in, like, 3 months because of injury. And I just happened to see the ad or whatever that was put out by AWE that said they were having a tryout show. And, like, something in my head said, like, I have to go there and I have to earn a spot. Like, no one's going to stop me from earning a spot. And that's exactly what happened. A lot of people have. I've seen people have very bad experiences with the Atlanta crowd because they are very brutal. But the second that I walked in there, they were nothing but a welcoming family to me because they enjoy my style and they appreciate me for what I am. And that's something I've searched for in a crowd for my entire career is someone who knows what I am so that I can further venture into that. And they've given me the opportunity and the platform to, like, really express to them the character that I've become.
Very cool. Very cool. In looking all over all the incredible talent that is in pro wrestling, and you've made some very specific points about, you know, who's stroking who to get to the front of the line and get that contract. What do you think the direction of the business will be in, say, 5 years with all this jockeying for position?
Well, I mean, I don't even think you have to look at the next 5 years necessarily, but look at what's happened in the last 5 years. Wrestling has evolved in an insane way that none of us could have expected, and none of us can really see where we'll be in the next 5 years, but we will absolutely be in a very, very different place. I think that's what ties in to the entire counterculture idea, is that there's a feeling, there's a vibe in the air that independent wrestling is dying for this specific contract era. But I think, like, the ultimate goal is to keep independent wrestling something different, something unique that only independent wrestling can provide and service to people. And I think that within that next 5 years, we're going to see a very strong delineation between what is independent wrestling and what is contract wrestling, to say it in a mild and understandable way.
That's a very, very valid point. Very, very good answer. Laura, go ahead.
Well, Bob, thank you for painting such a great and upstanding picture of myself. I do appreciate that. You know, what do they say? I'd rather laugh with the sinners than cry with the saints. The sinners are much more fun.
I hear you, girl.
Welcome to the show, Tripp. Tripp Cassidy, that if that isn't a wrestler's name, I don't know what is. That is such a great name. Seriously.
Thank
Where did you
so
come
much.
Up with that?
It's really, really dumb. it sounds like a cool name. It sounds really unique, but like when it breaks down to it, it makes me sound much, much less cool. When I was in middle school, high school, do you guys remember those old, those ridiculous baggy pants that all the emo alternative kids would wear that had chains and spikes all over them?
Yeah.
Yep. The brand was called Tripp NYC. So that was the original origin of the Tripp Cassidy name.
That's awesome. You know, I always wondered how you didn't trip. I mean, seriously, because, I mean, the pant leg was, like, huge.
Right, right.
That's funny.
I got to stop. Hold on a second. Are you trying to tell me an anti-establishment guy got his name from an established clothing line?
That would be it. I mean, as far as anti-establishment of Hot Topic goes.
That's good stuff. I'm sorry, I couldn't help.
No, that's fine. But doesn't that kind of make it even cooler in a sense that you took something like that and made it your own?
It's definitely something. When I came up with the name, I was 13 years old. So, yeah, I've been doing well for myself with it.
You know, hey, why not? I saw something on your I saw something on Coach Mikey's Facebook page, and he had tagged you in it. And the title of the video was, I don't know whether I'm helping Ethan Case move or Tripp Cassidy. So I didn't really get the reference. So could you explain that?
Well, a little internal wrestling locker rooms is that Ethan Case is my twin, and we're both just matching. Yeah, me and Ethan Case are twins. And ironically enough, I'd never met Ethan Case, but at the time, I'd never met Ethan Case, and I randomly, like maybe 2 years ago, got a Facebook message from him that was just like, brother, we're twins, or something like that. Like, and from then on, like I've never got along so closely with anybody in my whole life than I have with Ethan.
Ethan is great. So, okay, that makes sense. I didn't know because he was doing some kind of a hand gesture, and I thought maybe that was it. But, yeah, I'll buy that for a dollar. Talking about Indiana, I also saw on your Facebook page that there's going to be a benefit for the hooligans coming up here pretty soon. The injuries that – was it Devin or Mason? I can't – right now
Mason.
I can't remember which one is Mason. Sustained were just horrendous. I've never seen, you know, injuries in wrestling like that. Tell us a little bit about that benefit show coming up.
The benefit is next Thursday at the WCWO Outlaw Arena. And, it's a slip and benefit show for the hooligans, for Mason and Devin. Mason, a lot of people, if anyone's ever seen the hooligans, Devin and Mason, on the outside, you know that they work a very difficult style to work. They're very... very high risk, very hard hitting. It's self-explanatory. And when things like that happen, like it's devastating, especially for guys like that with the outlaw lifestyle and live off wrestling. And those dudes, like Devin and Mason, are very like gruff in their ways because they're very old school. But those guys have helped the scene here and the scene all across the independents in a dramatic way. And, They've given me a lot. They've given, you know, Kerry and Iggy a lot. They've really helped, like, Big Brother independent wrestling in the best way possible. And I feel like, you know, everybody on the Indies can kind of relate to them. And if it's not that you know them and you know how they are and you feel like kin or your family with them, it's that you feel a closeness just because of the way that they live their life. And they live a lifestyle that everybody kind of dreams of, you know? On the road, outlaw life, wrestling is everything. And when that takes something away and you don't have the opportunity to do your livelihood anymore, it's up to us as a brotherhood, as professional wrestling, to give back in every way we can. So the guys and girls that are giving their body and their time and their opportunity to show people how much they care about the hooligans, I really think the given roster in the locker room there, while it's made up of mostly local guys, like, it's a lot of dudes that were sincerely affected by Devin and Mason and honestly, like, want to give back everything they can.
Well, that's awesome. It's a great story, especially, you know, in wrestling, because we were just talking about that quest for contracts just a little bit ago, and it's good to see that, you know, people can come together and put aside, you know, their interests for, you know, at least a little bit to come together and help someone who really needs the help. The x-rays and the pictures were just, I couldn't believe he'd gotten that from, his legs hit the guardrail, I believe is what it was, I had read.
Yep.
And guys, if you haven't seen those photos, I mean, it is just, wow. I mean, I've never seen anything like that in wrestling. It was bad. So, you know, if you're in that area, you know, come on out and help a couple of good brothers who obviously have helped a whole lot of people. I've seen them at AML Wrestling in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, and they are a sight to see. If you've never seen them wrestle, it is quite different than what you're seeing on the indies right now. And they kind of remind me of the Moondogs a little bit, you know, very unorthodox. They come in like bibbed overalls, and I think they wrestled barefoot. I think I remember that. Just incredible. Cats and nose rings and just incredible. So if you're out in that area, you know, go support a couple of people that really need it at this time. Want to switch gears a little bit and talk about your Carney compadres. I have seen Nick and Carrie at PWX in North Carolina. I was really impressed with their costumes and the way it ties in with the gimmick. Incredible, looking sharp. And with the addition of Priscilla, it seems like that you guys are really the modern-day Four Horsemen, because you guys are taking care of one another. You're actually invested in each other's futures. You're trying to push each other as far as you possibly can. And I don't know if you see that a whole lot in independent wrestling nowadays.
Right. Yeah, like I said, we're definitely very goal-oriented and very driven as one unit. And, I mean, myself and Carrie, we spent like 7 hours on the phone the other day, like between the span of a week. Like, we all share very, very close bonds, whether it be personal or professional. Like, I feel like between the four of us, any of us can come to anyone with any of our personal lives or professional lives with anything. We're absolutely always on one page together.
Well, it shows. It certainly shows in your adventures in Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment. And speaking of Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment, I ask everyone who has ever wrestled for Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment this question who comes on the show. Do you have a funny Joshua Von Wheeler story?
Oh, man. I'm not sure if I have any funny Josh stories. Josh is definitely a volatile personality, but I love him. He's kind of the best kind of nutcase. My favorite Josh.
Yes, he is.
Yeah.
So
Josh,
no.
My favorite Joshism is his ridiculous intros for everyone. Like the fact that Josh intros all the matches. It really makes my day because he's absolutely out of his mind.
I would agree with that. He's been on the show a couple times, and it's I don't think Live from the Armory is ever the same after he comes on. Would you, Bob?
No, I wouldn't. And he posted something the other day about escaping from a Church of Scientology camp 4 years ago or something like that. And I'm just like, oh, my God.
Do what?
Only Josh. He posted something goofy that he had escaped from a Church of Scientology camp like 4 years ago not to accept checks from unknown friends or something. He's just, he is a unique individual.
Perfect. That is totally awesome. Well, since we've seen Nick and Carrie up in PWX, when are we going to see you up in the Carolinas?
I've been in PWX once recently with Nick and Carrie against the Ugly Ducklings. That was one of the best matches of all 2016 for us, and one of the best matches that we've ever had as a unit. I wrestle frequently for CWF Mid-Atlantic in North Carolina. CWF's been a really close home for me. Yeah, absolutely.
Now, were you on the CHIKARA shows that they did up in Gibsonville?
No. All my CHIKARA experience has been between Indiana, Illinois, Pennsylvania, and New York City.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. I thought maybe I had seen you and just didn't realize it. Yeah. Brad and company put on a great product at CWF Mid-Atlantic. That's for sure. But I'm going to let Bob take over. I know he's probably have some questions he's dying to ask.
I always have questions. I always have questions of a curious nature. Now, there's some big things coming up, obviously, Tripp, not only for yourself, but Nick and Carrie. I know that Priscilla has a huge opportunity in front of her coming up at the next Shine event. I believe that she's going to wrestle Ariel Monroe to find out who gets a spot on the Shine roster, if I'm not mistaken, at Shine 41. And there is a wave of violence coming to AWE in May. Do you plan to be a part of it? And if so, how will it shape Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment for the rest of 2017?
AWE is a very interesting place, being that we've found our crowd, we've found our audience in particular, be it through the internet or through live physical audience, and it's definitely in an evolving period that's very sink or swim. I'm sure Josh has mentioned this before in plenty of ways, and you've seen his Facebook posts. Atlanta Wrestling is it's very volatile because it's very emotional and very passionate from every individual on the roster. And I can't count the amount of different anxieties and different panics and the tears and the insane emotional response between the locker room, between the crowd. Every show is an experience. And moving forward in 2017, it's going to be very, very different. The guys that put in the work ethic to make AWE what it is and that are continuing to put in the work ethic to make AWE something better in the future, I have very, very strong confidence in. And it's definitely the most counterculture-related product that you're going to find in the independents.
And that's what people have been waiting for. I mean, there are several promotions, I'm not going to name names because it does no good, that ride off of the big ticket sale, big name main event, but the shows lack the emotional investment, not only from the fans' perspective, but from the locker room. In essence, Tripp, isn't that what AWE has found? Is that emotional investment on both ends?
Oh, yeah. I can't tell you how many times Josh has given the talk about how he doesn't know if it's worth it. And I don't think Josh sees what the boys see and what everyone else sees, because Josh is so driven towards success, and he works very, very hard to make Atlanta a place for wrestling. He's put everything he has into it, and you can see it, you know. Whether you know him well or whether you don't know him at all, like, you can see that everything Josh lives and breathes for is Atlanta wrestling. And for the crowd that he's got, like, there may not be 10,000 people in the crowd, but the people that are there, it's the theory of, like, if I'm on Facebook or Twitter, like if I'm on Twitter, am I going to have 20,000 fans that aren't going to look at any of my content or share anything or care about what I'm doing? Or would I rather have 2,000 people that are going to share everything and love everything I do? Atlanta Wrestling doesn't have auditorium-sized venues. Atlanta Wrestling doesn't have 30,000 fans or anything. But Atlanta Wrestling, for the 200 people that are there and growing, it is growing in physical numbers, but the few people that are there, everyone genuinely cares. I never get more response through Facebook or Facebook messages or fans buying merch. I never get anything more from anyone than I do from the AWE crowd, because every single one of them, they want to interact with the wrestlers individually, with the show. They want to feel like they're a part of something. And they know, everyone at Atlanta knows, and we wouldn't be having this conversation about AWE if it wasn't for the fact that everyone knows there's something very, very special and very unique going on there.
Well, you mentioned two things that we're going to cover right now. For fans that want to connect with you on social media, Tripp, how can they do that?
It's pretty simple. I've been blessed with the opportunity to have a name that's very unique in a social media presence. So
right,
everything's just at Tripp Cassidy, TrippCassidy. Super simple.
Well, that's the way we love it. We try to keep it simple for everybody. If fans want to get a hold of some of that elusive Tripp Cassidy merchandise, how can they do that? I mean, obviously at a show, but do you have a pro wrestling tee side, anything like that?
I do. I usually carry as much physical merch as possible with me, and it makes people in every carload hate me, but it is what it is. I'm a carny. I got to sell my stuff. But I do have a pro wrestling tee store. I've got a fully gimmick store. I've got, I think, a What a Maneuver store. I have multiple avenues in which I can sell merchandise, and I plug them as much as humanly possible so people have that opportunity, because I don't just put out merch that's like, oh, I think I can sell some of these T-shirts if I, like, try and fool people. Myself, Carrie, and Iggy, like I said, when we go through merchandise stuff together, like, I check all my stuff with everyone because I design almost everything myself. I've had the pleasure of having a few things designed by Fully Gimmicked, and that's always fantastic because they know me so well. But I refuse to put out anything that I feel like is less than fantastic quality content that I can give to somebody that I feel the pleasure of knowing someone owns a mark.
Very cool. That makes sense. The last thing that we ask all of our guests to do, Tripp, if you could record an audio bump for us, if you could say something like, this is Tripp Cassidy, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, that would be great, and you could go when you'd like.
This is the Blue-Eyed Devil, Tripp Cassidy, and you're listening to Live from the Armory.
Very cool. Very cool.
Awesome.
Tripp, we thank you so much for taking time out to be with us, man. We certainly appreciated having you on the show, man. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Thank you guys so much. I love it. I love doing podcasts, and you guys have been fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. You have a great day, okay?
You too. Take care.
Folks, we'll be right back to talk about Laura's thin moral fiber and talk a little bit more about Tripp Cassidy right after this brief message.
Hey everyone, lovely Laura here to tell you that old Bunkhouse Bob begged for a year to get Turnbuckle Cupcake to make him a cupcake. And it was so good, he can't stop talking about them in 2017.
That's right, Laura. I mean, what could be better than watching wrestling, other than watching wrestling, and enjoying a cupcake from Brandy and Julianne at Turnbuckle Cupcakes?
You know, they have other things too, Bob. Crochet items, cupcake click shirts, and much more. Endorsed by wrestling fans and wrestlers from around the globe, it's a no-brainer, which should make it easy for you.
I'm a wrestling genius, not a confectionery consultant. Folks, find Turnbuckle Cupcakes on Facebook or visit them at www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com. We had a really great time getting to talk with Tripp Cassidy, didn't we, Laura?
Sure did. You just
I really just like the whole counterculture and how he has incorporated that into wrestling, especially, you know, you don't necessarily have to get that contract to be successful.
Yeah, and you and I talked about it after we got done speaking with Tripp. And again, want to thank Tripp Cassidy for his time. Full disclosure, folks, we recorded this very early on a Sunday morning, not this past Sunday, the week after. That was, you heard a couple of date references in there. Obviously, Shine 41 has already took place. Unfortunately, Priscilla came out on the losing end of that particular match, and the benefit show for Devin and Mason has already taken place as well. So we were about a week out on this. But after we got done, we were talking about it, Laura and I were, and what a better concept. You know, he talked about being involved with a group of people that are goal-oriented, have the same common, or on the same common path. And we, you know, and in discussing it, what an idea, you know, what a concept for them, in the sense that if you need a tag team, you've got a tag team with Nick and Carrie. You need a singles wrestler, you've got Tripp. You need a women's wrestler, you've got Priscilla. You need a mixed tag, you've got, you know, that. You've got a stable, you've got anything that you could want in bringing in not just one person, but the entire group. And, you know, them traveling together and doing things, it all works. It works for them. And their social media posts, if you haven't checked out the Carnies, you know, Nick Eagy, Carrie Awful, Priscilla Kelly, Tripp Cassidy, you can see that their social media posts, the things that they put out on YouTube, are all, they're very specific. They're very driven in presenting them as the product, which it should be. You know, it's something for some to take notes on. Would you agree?
Oh, most certainly. Because we talked about this. If you bring the Carnies up to your promotion, you've got a tag team. You've got a singles wrestler.
All right.
And you've got a woman wrestler.
Yeah. Yeah.
Bam.
Yep. It makes sense. It's all right there. All at your disposal. So awesome to talk to Tripp Cassidy about, you know, not only Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment, but he mentioned CWF Mid-Atlantic. He also mentioned the wrestling scene in Indiana. And it was very, very cool to have the opportunity to talk to him. So again, we want to thank Tripp Cassidy for making time out for us and having a little wrestling chat with us, so to speak. And I'll need to message him and ask him if there's a way that you can repair your thin moral fiber, or if it's broken beyond repair.
Okay, let's talk about that. How in this world do you arrive at the conclusion that I have a thin moral fiber?
Well, you said it yourself. You'd rather laugh with the sinners than cry with the saints. So I'm just reiterating what you
said. I was quoting Mr. Billy Joel.
Yeah, well, okay.
Do you not know that, Bob?
I'm not a Billy Joel fan, no. Why should I be a Billy? Why are we talking about Billy Joel?
Because that's where I got that quote from.
Oh, all right. Well, why don't you quote off some indie events, and then we'll get to this announcement that everybody's been hanging around, lingering around for.
What am I doing hanging around? Hang on just a second.
No.
And I bet some of you people know what that song was. Get extra points if you do. AAW presents Homecoming Friday, March 17th at the Berwyn Eagles Club in Berwyn, Illinois. You can find out more information by visiting www.aawrestling.com. IWR presents Collision Course Saturday, March 18th at the Colgate High School Gym in Colgate, Oklahoma. You can find out more information by visiting www.imperialwrestlingrevolution.com. Elite Championship Wrestling, Saturday, March 18th at the American Legion Post 33 in Pensacola, Florida. I also have a show on Sunday, March 19th at the Chat Bay Fairgrounds in Chat Bay, Louisiana. You can find out more information by visiting www.elitechampionshipwrestling.com. Wildcat Sports presents Hey Yo! With special appearance by, With special appearance by WWE Hall of Fame Scott Hall.
That'll
teach me to read the notes in advance. Saturday, March 18th at the Mesler Middle School in Metairie, Louisiana. You can find out more information by visiting www.wildcatwrestling.com. We love you, Luke.
You were confused there because that came out, that the first Hey Yo came out like you were doing a musical. And the second Hey Yo was like a very bad Scott Hall impersonation.
Hey, I didn't say that I could do a good Scott Hall.
Just start calling you Chico. Hey, Chico.
Chica. Learn your Spanish.
Well, I couldn't ask for a better segue than to learn Spanish. Because we may need to learn just a little bit of Spanish. We've been alluding to it all day long on social media, and it's no coincidence, folks, that today was the launch of Lucha Underground on Netflix, Season 1, Season 2. Coming up on this show next week, very excited to have this gentleman on the program. Some of you may remember him from his NXT days as Judas Devlin. Some of you may simply know him as Austin from the hit reality show from CBS, Big Brother. Others of you may know him as the Luchasaurus. You may know him as Vibora from Lucha Underground. Coming up, yes, next week, Austin Madelson, I believe is how it's pronounced, from Lucha Underground will be joining us next week. We're going to find out about what's going to happen within reason for the rest of 2017 for Lucha Underground. A lot of eyes on the product now that it is out on Netflix. We're going to talk to him about Cobra Moon and everything that's going on at the temple, all the ins and outs, Pentagon Jr., Pentagon Dark now, the Worldwide Underground, Johnny Mundo, Sexy Star. We're going to cover it all. We're going to talk to him about the phenomenon that is Lucha Underground next week. So that should be pretty cool. I'm pretty excited about this one.
I'm ecstatic. I really am. I got a little caught up with Twitter because at our co-executive producer, George Pohl, says, you know, I have an idea for a show with all the musical references. I think it's time we get a musician on.
I know a few musicians. What George is really trying to say is that he has become bored. And what he wants to do is he wants to produce Live from the Armory, the musical, is what George is wanting to do. Last week, it was Freaky Friday, and now this week, it's Live from the Armory, the musical.
And I just want to say real quick, thank you, Dr. Gooseltron, for knowing that was a monkey lyric. Oh, yeah. Just want to say, you get me.
See, folks,
Dr. Goose, he knows.
Yeah, Dr. Goose knows. See, you get it all. You get Billy Joel, the monkeys. You get Lucha Underground, you get the Carnies, you get musicals, you get all kinds of references. We cover it all here on Live from the Armory Wrestling Show.
The Jack and Jill of all trades.
Pretty much.
Oh, and real quick, wanted to give a shout out to previous show guest Cedric Alexander and saying, Sadie, we wish you, a speedy recovery. You got to get back in that ring and win that Cruiserweight title. That's what I've been waiting on.
Yeah. A lot of speculation is 3 to 5 months. You know that Cedric is in excellent shape, and we certainly hope that the rehab goes well, and hope to see him back in the ring very, very soon. Very exciting, talented individual. like to see Cedric back in the WWE ring as soon as possible. That's for sure. Anything else that you got coming across your plate, across your mind?
Well, real quick, George says the Live from the Armory musical is a license to print money and license to ill as well. Yes, because we all feel old because it's the 30th anniversary of the release of License to Ill. If you don't know what that is, go Google. Google that shit. Yeah, I feel old. I was in the seventh freaking grade when that thing came out. Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. License to Ill. No, what it is George says, it says that it's a license to print money because if we had a Live from the Armory musical, we'd have to give out refunds, and it would be a license to Ill. Everybody would be getting sick over it because you don't want to hear me sing show tunes.
Oh, I got a, you know, I, you know, Bob thinks he's a genius. Conley Aid.
You're working on the soundtrack already?
Yeah, Taco Slap.
Oh, my God. Oh, here it comes. folks, we're going to have to shut her down for sure now, bud. She's sucking mud.
I can't breathe.
That's the second week in a row that you've not been able to breathe. Unbelievable. Is there anything else that we have before we get the plug pulled on us now?
I would like to thank all of our listeners. And I would just like to throw this out. Hey, you know, wrestlers, if you're doing the drives and making the towns on the weekends or even the week, like the Ugly Duckling and Mr. Timothy Lou Retton, they're going to Rockstar Pro Wrestling. They left this morning. You know, download us and give us a listen. I guarantee you'll be entertained by something. I mean, we have 159 episodes. There's got to be something in there that would entertain you. If you have a really long road trip, listen to the episode where George and I and the Tommy Thomas talk about the ending, the series finale of How I Met Your Mother. Or listen to Cliff Compton tell about his trials and tribulations at an airport rental, car rental counter. Joey Ryan is a great listen. Bob Evans. It's a great listen. So, you know, just saying, give us a shot. You know, you've got some time to kill. Why not listen to us?
Absolutely. You can go back into the archives, like Laura was saying. Over 159 episodes and counting now, well over 200 guests from today's independent wrestling scene, covering everybody from Cedric Alexander all the way up to Tripp Cassidy. You can't go wrong. You can check that out. Go to www.livefromthearmory.com. You can check us out on iTunes. You can check us out on Stitcher. Go to fnx.network. Subscribe. Do all that good stuff. Check it out. It's a labor of love. It's fun. And that's it. You got anything else?
I am done, Bob.
I imagine you are. I imagine you are. Catch your breath because we got a big show next week. Folks, we thank you for tuning in. We'll be back here next Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern time, with Austin, a.k.a. Lucha Underground's Viboro. Viboro. I got to practice my Spanish.
Viboro. Viboro, gringo.
Viboro. Yeah, I got to try. Folks, remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. We'll see you next week. Thanks for listening.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network and we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
Everybody, Bunkhouse Bob here. Laura, do you know what the NRA stands for?
Of course. It stands for the National Rifle Association.
No, it doesn't. It stands for National Wrestling Association. And if you're into wrestling like Laura and I are, you should check out the Wrestling Warehouse.
Specializing in wrestling memorabilia, including WWE, NXT, TNA, ECW, WCW, and more. Wrestling Warehouse has wrestling figures, autographed merchandise, apparel, and will buy, sell, or trade.
You can connect with Justin at the Wrestling Warehouse via Facebook. Go and like the page and tell them Bunkhouse Bob and Lovely Laura sent you to the Wrestling Warehouse.